It's time once again to slip into your camo, grab your bow, and join us out in the field for another episode of the Up North Journal, presented by PSE Archery. The Up North Journal crew is knocked and ready to rock for another exciting adventure. So let's step outside and hit the trail.
This episode of the Up North Journal podcast is brought to you by
PSE Archery, Yamaha Outboards, Better the Hunt, Easy Cut, Packer Max, Deer Camp Coffee, Buck Baits, JPO Game Calls, Limwalker Game Calls, Wild Seasoning, Total Peep, Sunrise Archery, Scent Lock, and Scent Blocker.
Welcome back to another episode of the Up North Journal, everybody. Host Mike Adams sitting in the cabin tonight on a blustery Wednesday afternoon here in mid-Michigan with Dan DeFaul. What is going on?
Oh, typical Michigan weather. Almost slipped off the front porch this morning, and my truck was an ice cube.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was nice to drive into work and watch the temperature kind of warm up.
Yeah, I had to scrape the windows this morning myself before I went to work. Tried to climb in the Jeep, and not thinking, put my foot on the step rail, and down I went.
Oh, did you really?
Yep, yeah. So, it's like, yeah, everything's slick outside. It's all iced up.
It is slick outside. There's no doubt about it. But I tell you what, it's good. We're heading to the right direction. I know they're getting a big snowstorm up in the UP. The hope is the snow doesn't stay.
Right, yeah. I think they're getting 6 to 12 up there tonight.
Right, exactly. Jennifer Drake.
Is it snowing at your place?
You know, anybody listening to the live stream on Facebook, if you're interested in a shed hunt this weekend coming up, get a hold of Jennifer Drake up in the northern lower. She has a shed hunt, and you can guys go do some shed hunting and whatnot. Just get a hold of her. She's in the chat right now, so if you got any questions, just send it to her. Give her some questions, but I think it's on Sunday.
Okay, right on. There you go. Good time to get outside.
Yeah, so, it's always a good time to get.
Well, let's get some of our sponsorship out of the way here and get into the show tonight.
Absolutely. I tell you what, I was down there today. I was down at Deer Camp, and I was checking out, and sure enough, saw the buck baits there. But if you go order off buckbaits.com, you can get 20% off your order if you use the promo code UNJ20. Lincoln Roan, who's enjoying some...
He's in Gulf Shores, Alabama.
He is. And if you'd like to talk to him about his Packer Max and get $25 off your order, go over to packermax.com or give him a call, talk to him. Wait till he comes back from vacation. Yeah, use the promo code UNJ25.
He was on the beach. He was selling cultipackers on the beach. Had a nice picture of him there. His legs are a little burnt.
I know, right? That's funny.
So.
JPO Game Calls. Tell you what, if you want to go check out some good game calls, get over to jpogamecalls.com. Use the promo code UNJ10. You'll get 10% off your order. Great friends of ours, Natalie and Jason, down at Island Armory. If you go to theislandarmory.com and go there often, because they're always updating what they have in stock with guns and ammo and stuff, use the promo code UNJ10. You get 10% off. Last but not least, we're drinking
Lucky Huntsman tonight.
The Lucky Huntsman. If you go to deercampcoffee.com and you use the promo code UNJ10, you'll get 10% off your order. And while you're there, why don't you get a bag of Up North Journal?
That's right. We have our own blend there. It is a medium roast. And Danny, do you got one of those little packages tonight? What we got?
I got one of these little. If you ever see us, ask us for a sampling pack.
Yeah, right there. Got a few of those.
We'll got a few of these. We're going to have these with us. All our members are going to try to have them with us. That way, if they want to try a sample, we'll give you 2 ounces of Up North Journal coffee.
There you go. Right. So what's going on up in the UP right now?
I tell you what, it is 32 degrees up in the UP.
Snow's melting.
Whoop, there it goes. Snow's melting. It's 32 degrees up in Newberry. Get over to Cedars, get some Deer Camp coffee, have a pizza, enjoy yourself in the UP, watch the snow melt.
Big shout out to FM123 for their camera there that actually carry our show. So we appreciate them streaming the Up North Journal podcast.
Absolutely.
All right, Danny.
I tell you what, I think we should talk a little bit quieter.
I know a man that could actually help us with that, I do believe.
Really?
Yeah, I think so.
Why don't we talk to Mr. Kinzer down in...
Augusta, Georgia.
Augusta,
you forgot
Georgia.
Where he was at.
No, because I was trying to come up with a correlation to the Masters next week, and I couldn't come up fast enough.
What's going on?
Can Hello, you, gentlemen.
What's going on in Augusta? Is it nice and warm down there and sunny? And I saw a palm tree earlier.
It's gorgeous. Palm trees. They're spray painting all the grass green, just so that the Masters is clean.
Right? For those of you who don't know, they do spray paint the grass.
No, the groundskeepers are that. Well, you saw him. He gave us a shot of his palm tree in his backyard. You saw how green his grass was.
That's right. Did you paint your grass too?
No, it's fine.
You just keep it manicured like that, and it's green all the time, right?
Cedric Perez says, "Hey, Kevin."
Hey there, Cedric. He's one of the dealers that we work with.
Excellent.
Awesome. Awesome guy.
Have them on, watching you live on Facebook with Up North Journal. And we're going to talk a little bit about suppressors. But first, we got to learn about GSL technology.
So you guys are actually, GSL technology is here in Michigan, but you're in Augusta. You work with them or for them. We want to learn a little more about suppressors. We want to learn the ins and outs, how they're made. How did you get your start with the company, and how did the company come about making suppressors?
So the suppressor, GSL, has been in business longer than I've been alive. Okay. Right? In 1985, Greg Latka started toying with suppressor designs and developing some based on some of his aerospace engineering background, and had done some components for space shuttles and satellites. And I think he's got a couple components that he built that are still on the moon.
Nice.
And so that's cool.
Not many people can say that.
Right. And so they started in aerospace engineering. And in 1985, GSL started doing suppressors.
Okay.
They're in Jackson, Michigan. And so they have a lot of experience in the business, obviously.
Okay. So right? They got a little time in making these, and he's got the know-how. How did you get involved with the company? When did you come into the company?
Me personally, I've been with GSL maybe 3.5 years or so now.
Okay.
And which doesn't really sound like a lot, but when you work 110 hours a week, it's almost like dog years, you know?
Right.
I hear you. Well, plus you, besides working all those hours, the way technology is going gangbusters, it's like overload.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So our manufacturing facility, you can see up there in Jackson, Michigan, it's 25,000 square feet, right? And we have a test fire range there at the facility.
Okay.
And so that's awesome. It's good to be able to put rounds down immediately.
So you guys, you're doing everything right there in-house. You take care of all of your own product. You don't have anything shipped out?
No. Unlike some other manufacturers in the industry, GSL does all of our products. We do all of our accessories and flash hiders and pistons, all of our components and Cerakoting and laser engraving is all done inside the same building.
Okay. Why is that so important in this piece of gear?
Part of it's important in maintaining our ISO 9000 rating, mm-hmm. right? We control every single step of the manufacturing process in-house. And so there's never a time where it's, oh, well, we're waiting on the Cerakote guys. I'm sorry, those parts aren't in yet, mm-hmm. right? Because our guys are the Cerakote guys.
Right, absolutely.
So if we need something re-Cerakoted, we just walk across the hallway and there's the Cerakote, you know?
Yeah, and if you do catch something that maybe doesn't meet a certain tolerance, you can immediately correct it. And take care of that if it's, you know, something in the code on a machine that, I mean, they're computers. Sometimes they get a little something in. But you guys got that immediate quality controls, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yep. We've got a dedicated QA department there at the shop. And we've got a weapons vault there at the shop as well.
Okay.
We've got some of our test fire equipment and some of our, Greg's vault. Pretty extensive.
I can imagine.
A lot of machine guns and just, you know, some really cool stuff to do as R&D and to get some new products on the market.
So how did Danny and I get a job there? No, I'm just kidding.
Well, I mean, we're hiring.
You guys
are
hiring.
It's very cool.
Okay.
It's very cool. We're hiring some machinists right now.
Okay.
And kind of running through some interviews, getting some guys that can run a CNC machines and, you know, kind of supplement that team, get some quality people in there,
right,
that are out there in Jackson.
Is that part of kind of what's going on now just throughout all of the employment industry? You know, people, they have a hard time keeping people. They're jumping from one place to the other. But I got to imagine you guys are probably the go-to place when it comes to somebody that wants to work hand-in-hand with firearms or firearm components.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, what's really interesting is that even after being in business, you know, for 3 decades, GSL is not extremely well known because they do a lot of private label manufacturing.
Okay.
Right. So they build suppressors for 8 other companies right now.
Gotcha.
right, where they'll build a suppressor, they'll stamp, you know, XYZ firearms on the outside of it and ship it to that facility. And then they sell them as their product under ATF variances.
Gotcha. Okay.
And so that was the bulk of their sales prior to 3 or 4 years ago. And they were doing a lot of private label machining, and they've kind of expanded out the GSL branded product line.
Nice.
And so right now we have 40 different models in current production.
Of different suppressors, styles, yeah, and all that. I got
different,
you. Okay.
Different suppressors for 22 and 9mm and 5.7, 223, and your 338s and your longer range stuff as well.
So I got to imagine with you guys doing all your work there in-house, you guys got to have some patents on this stuff and whole patents on this.
We definitely do, right? We've got some dating back to the 80s.
Okay.
Right? The 80s and 90s. We've got 9 patents in the industry right now. And so just different designs. I mean, the first time I met Greg, I was speaking with him about these patents, and he had said, I don't spend nearly as much time messing with patents as I do ensuring that our cans, you know, are consistent and are ensuring, you know, POI shift and ensuring that they've got a quality product. You know, they don't care nearly as much about decibels as they do about the actual suppressor itself. Okay. You know, there in that photo you can see some of the accessories and different flash hiders and mounts and components, and see some of the product line. It's one of the most diverse product lines in the market.
Yeah, I was impressed. I mean, you know, when I was looking at the different photos, you guys have got quite a lineup of different cans for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
And, you know, and that gives you, you know, that gives you that wide variety you need when you have different types of customers coming in the door looking for something that they wanted to buy. You give them that luxury of giving them a lineup of, hey, we can take care of you. You just got to tell us what you need and what you want, right?
Sure. There is not one suppressor that fires every single weapon and every caliber and every platform and does it well, you know, as far as sound reduction. And likewise, I mean, there's not a magazine that can feed 22 caliber ammo and feed 338 ammo, right?
Right.
That's right.
There's no barrel that you could use for both of those calibers. And so it's just, it's very interesting.
There is no there is no magic one silver suppressor.
Well, sure.
Well, let me ask you, I mean, since we're kind of talking down this line now, let's say I've got two different rifles, both of them 5.56 or both of them maybe a 308. Would each rifle in that caliber use the same can or suppressor? Or is there a, maybe depending on the model, is there a better one for a different rifle? Does that even make sense or not?
So a suppressor that's designed for 223 or 5.56, it can definitely swap between other 5.56 and 223 weapons.
Okay.
Right? There's a myth in the suppressor industry that, you know, a suppressor gets tied to one weapon and has to live on that specific weapon.
Gotcha.
Its whole life, and that is not true at all. If you have multiple ARs in your family and you're swapping between them, you can do that, right, with quick disconnect suppressors, have flash hiders on each of those weapons, and be able to swap the can between them.
Okay, that makes sense.
And so same with 308, same with, you know, the gamut of caliber spectrums.
Okay, so basically, you know, we're just talking mainly about the caliber.
Yeah.
The difference.
Yeah, yeah. Caliber makes a huge difference, you know. The hole for a 9mm suppressor and the hole for a 223 suppressor, right? You'd think that you should be able to fire 223 through every single 9mm suppressor. And that is not true at all.
Okay.
Right? Because 9mm is a very different bullet. It's moving a lot slower. It's a lot larger. And so you've tried and fire a 223 or a 300 blackout or a 308 through a suppressor that was designed for 9mm, and it could blow up, you know?
Great.
So
Danny, pay attention.
So it's definitely something you have to, you know, consider when looking at suppressors.
Okay.
Absolutely. You know? That's one of the things, you know, you look at getting into this. There's a whole bunch of questions that people got out there about these. Do a little homework. Talk with some professionals. Get their opinions. See what they're doing. They should know, like at Island Armory, Natalie, Jason. Talk with them. Give them a call. Proud supporter of the journal. And, you know, they'll answer your questions. And that's what's nice about those two down there at Island Armory. You know, give them a call. Mike, you give them a call. Talk to them. Answer some of your questions.
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, we got some questions coming in here.
We do.
Let's take a quick question here. So, Mark asks, he says, can I add a suppressor to my guns myself, or do I need a gunsmith to do that?
Mark, that is an awesome question. Most scenarios, you do not need a gunsmith to add a suppressor. Okay. A lot of pistols, right? Like Glocks and your Smith & Wesson, they have drop-in barrels, right? So you could get one from, you know, from a barrel distributor, drop it right into your Glock without major gunsmithing work or removing pins or anything crazy. As far as rifles, you know, most of your ARs, your 223, your 5.56 weapons, they're already threaded, right? Right underneath the flash hider on the end of your weapon, right? There are threads already there, and you pull those off, right? You can take it off with a 3/4 inch wrench, pull it off, clean the threads off, right? Acetone, put some Loctite on there, and you can thread the GSL Bi-Lock flash hider down on there. And that's simple, right? We also have some direct thread units available. So you take the flash hider off and you thread the can directly on there, and then you can just leave the suppressor on the weapon. So no, you definitely don't have to be a gunsmith, right? You really don't need a ton of firearms, you know, background in order to use suppressors, right? A lot of them are very low maintenance.
Okay.
Exactly. And you know, and basically another question is, are they legal for hunting in the states, all states, some states?
Suppressors are completely legal to own, right? They're legal to hunt with. They're legal for self-defense. They're legal for carrying in almost every state, right? Can you see this map?
Yep.
Do you have that image?
Yeah, hang on. I tell you what, I'm going to drop your name off here. There we go. Yeah, except for the big three there. What I like to call the big three.
Yep. So there are currently 42 states where suppressors are completely legal to own, hunt with, travel with. And so when you have that license and you have that ability to take your suppressor out, you can travel through any of those states completely legally.
There you go. You just got to drive there around those couple.
Right? Exactly.
Yeah, just drive around a few of them.
There you go.
Those are the safe states.
That's right.
That's where the lowest crime rate is in New York, Illinois, and California.
That's right. Exactly.
Funny how that works, right?
Right?
Yeah. Huh? one more quick question here before we go to a break. You know, you guys are here in Michigan. Where at exactly in Michigan are you located?
GSL is in Jackson, Michigan.
Jackson, okay. Well, right. Somebody was asking about the employment, if there was anything outside of the Jackson area. Do you have any other facilities maybe up here in mid-Michigan?
We do not, right? Okay. We have some of the dealers and some of the agencies that we work with, but we don't have a potential employment opportunities outside of Jackson, really.
Okay. Tell you what, let's take a quick break here, and we come back. There's a lot of questions in here, actually, but we'll be right back after this.
PSE Archery has reinvented the way you buy bows.
From now on, you can make the most educated decision possible
by basing your bow choice specifically on your shooting needs and goals.
All you need to do is ask yourself, what kind of shooter am I? What do I want to achieve?
PSE will help find the right category for you.
So, what kind of shooter are you?
Find out at PSEArchery.com.
Welcome back. Second segment of the show. We're talking about keeping things quiet on the gun range and in the field when you're using your firearms. Speaking of that, you know, we see, you know, you're supposed to wear your hearing protection when you're on the range. I've shot suppressed rifles a couple times, and I was amazed at the difference it makes in just the difference in noise level, the decibels, when, you know, you can actually shoot with your muffs off. I was actually blown away at how much they actually take that noise level down. With that being mine and safety, is there anything else as far as safety that we need to be really cognizant of when using a suppressor? That's one of the questions that came in.
Yes, definitely there is, right? Suppressors do not stop the bullet from coming out of the barrel.
There you go.
Okay? Right. A lot of people, because of the reduction of the sound and the flash and the heat signature and everything, because of the way a suppressor functions, some people start to become more complacent on their firearm safety.
Really?
And so that's really something to be cognizant of, is that you're not, that you're not complacent and realize that it's still a very deadly weapon. You know?
Absolutely. You know, you know that's one of the things that safety is always about being first. So, like you said, as you get used to using a suppressor and the reaction you're getting from it, you get that like days it shouldn't really. You know, like you talked about maintenance of this of the threads and everything on the end of that rifle. Can you use just like a basic gun cleaning kit to work the area like that? So you mentioned acetone.
Yeah, that was just in clearing some of the threads. Okay. The thing about suppressors that people really get wrapped around the axle on is that as firearms owners, right, we tear apart our weapons and we scrape every piece of carbon off of our firing pins. Right, we spend a lot of time making sure that they operate successfully. Right.
Absolutely
correct.
You better be.
So. Right. And so if you liken the ability of the bolt carrier group and the weapon to move successfully, like, say, the components in an engine in a car,
mm-hmm.
right? And you're going to oil those, you're going to clean them, you're going to clean out the air filter and lube it, right?
Mm-hmm.
How many times in your life have you ever cut the muffler off of the car to clean it?
Usually it falls off at some point.
Right. The muffler usually outlives the car,
right?
Right, or falls off,
right?
But you never clean it, right?
Right,
absolutely. Or
your
catalytic converter gets plugged because it's
sure or stolen.
Well, yeah, yeah, right. That's another one, right?
Or stolen. So that's something to consider in everything above 9mm. Okay, mm-hmm. So for 223, 308, 300 blackout, you will never need to clean those suppressors ever. Okay. You just shoot them, okay? For things that are below 9mm, 9mm, 22, 17 HMR, right? Those are a little bit more dirty. There's more lead deposits. There's little pieces of the metal that get shaved off as the powder residue and all that stuff,
mm-hmm.
right? So 22 caliber suppressors are most often user serviceable.
Okay.
Right? So you can tear it apart. You can pull the baffle stack apart and clean it. To the comment about the cleaning kit, average gun cleaning kit, what I'd use to clean 22 caliber suppressors is generally simple green, right? And I'll mix it 50-50 with water, put my baffles inside of it, right? Mm-hmm. I'll pull the baffles from the can, drop them in a rocks glass filled with that simple green.
Okay.
And I can brush them off with like a nylon brush and just clear off the deposits and the carbon and everything. You know,
so maintenance is something you don't you should not overlook on certain ones.
Right. On 22 caliber.
Okay.
Specifically. Okay. Right?
It's basically a dirty round.
Yeah, it's a dirty round for sure.
And poor Denny Steiner, he lives in Illinois and he goes, that figures. Illinois is on the no list.
Of course it's on the no list. Come on, Denny, you ought to know that.
Right.
But
you can move. You can move to pretty much anywhere else in the U.S.
That's right. Yeah. Anywhere right. between have, California, New York, anywhere. Anywhere between, right? Except Illinois.
Pretty much anywhere else, and have bald eagles and Budweiser and the, you know, Constitution.
There you go.
Well, that's it, right? And I tell you what, talking about suppressors, you know, when you get your youngsters involved in it and everything, and you want to talk, you know, you get them involved, you get them the hearing protection, and then the loud pop of the gun or noise of the gun. I tell you what, you can get these suppressors put on pistols, and we're showing the picture of the youngster shooting the pistol that's basically the suppressors longer than the pistol, and that's awesome. It's just one of those things, but if it helps get them out in the field and take care of it, that works. Just like you got a picture up now of that youngster shooting, looks like he's shooting out of the back foot.
Yeah, on a bipod.
Yep.
Off a tripod.
So suppressors do a lot more than reduce the sound of a weapon, right? They are great. Absolutely incredible for teaching new shooters, because it will reduce the shock factor, right? When you can reduce the report of the weapon and the recoil of the weapon, right, it makes it safer for new shooters that are learning to shoot, right? Of course, it's going to help prevent long-term hearing damage,
mm-hmm.
and that's awesome. But if you can get your rounds more consistently on target, right, and the weapon's more controllable, the recoil's reduced, that kid on the back of the truck is just incredible. You know, that's awesome.
It's it makes it a lot more enjoyable for everybody involved.
Exactly.
So you're saying it has a braking action to it, like a muzzle brake.
Correct. I mean, the best compensator, the best brake in the world is a suppressor.
There you go.
You know, the bullet goes right through the middle. Right. The bullet is not slowed down. But what happens is the gas that it's escaping, right? Instead of the gas and the powder and the flash all coming out at the same time of the barrel, with a suppressor, those things are all slowed down and they escape slower. And so that helps control the recoil and obviously lowers the sound, you know, the decibel reduction.
Speaking of decibel reduction, on average, what are we talking here? How much are we going to be able to drop the crack on a rifle?
So that's definitely a caliber-specific question. Mm-hmm. You know, all of our suppressors are rated for sound reduction, right? There's not a really good standard for, you know, there's not a really good industry standard for how you measure decibels. So some manufacturer might say, hey, this suppressor is rated for 113 decibels.
Okay.
And that doesn't really mean much to you, you know?
Where are they measuring it from?
Because where are they measuring from? What weapon are they using? Right. Are they at sea level or are they in Boulder, Colorado?
Yeah.
Right? Is there humidity? Is there rain? There's so many factors that go into sound that it's very difficult to have a great standard for measuring them, right?
Right. And depends on the round you're using, how hot a round it is.
Exactly. Subsonic rounds, powder, bullet weight. There's so many things that go into it. And so what GSL has done for sound reduction is that all of our suppressors are rated for decibel reduction levels. So if you fire one bullet and you get X, and then you put on the suppressor and you fire the same bullet, you know, with the same conditions, the same ammo, the same location, that is the estimated reduction that you would expect to see between that unsuppressed and suppressed shot.
Gotcha.
Right? So this guy I've got here is our most popular selling 22 suppressor, and it's called the Woodland 22.
Okay.
And it does 40 decibels of reduction.
Wow, that's significant.
Okay. Which is, yeah, it's definitely significant. It gets the 22 down completely hearing safe, which is awesome.
The thing I got to think about that, okay, this is for a 22. What's the first thing you're going to teach a kid to shoot with?
A
22.
Usually.
You know, so start them out young, you know, and that's, I've got tinnitus, you know, I've shot before when I was a lot younger without hearing protection, not to mention music and everything else, but I've got a constant ringing in my ear. I'd give anything if I would have started with hearing protection or a suppressed rifle when I was younger that would have stopped that. So it's a...
same here.
Would you know approximately... One of the questions coming in is that he shoots a 6.5 Creedmoor. With a can, would you know approximately how much decibel reduction that would have on a 6.5?
Non-subsonic ammo versus... So subsonic versus subsonic. Subsonic versus supersonic is definitely a huge question that comes up with suppressors. Okay, a subsonic bullet means that it does not exceed 1050 feet per second. Okay, that's the speed of sound. And so as soon as a bullet goes over that and hits, you know, 2000 feet per second, like a 223, right, is around 3000 feet per second. As soon as a bullet breaks that sound barrier, it produces an audible crack that you cannot suppress, right? Even the best suppressors in the world, like, you're still going to hear that supersonic crack.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For the 6.5 Creedmoor, GSL has developed a suppressor specifically for that caliber. It's called the GSL GT Mag 6.5. And that suppressor is made entirely of titanium, and it's rated for 28 decibels of reduction. Okay. So regardless of whether you're using standard velocity or subsonic ammo, you will still see the same reduction of the bullet, right?
Okay.
Between shots. So it's difficult to kind of compare apples to apples because not a lot of other manufacturers are really rating their cans for reduction yet. But what that does do is give you a good metric for, you know, what that perceived sound difference would be.
Okay. So you're measuring decibel reduction versus a percentage of reduction.
Correct.
Which
it's not. Yeah, it's not even a fixed percentage. It's not 10% or 20%. These are actually, you know, decibel reduction. 28 decibels is
what,
you know,
it's going to reduce it at. No matter if it's high or a little lower, it's going to be
right.
28 off of that top end. Gotcha.
Correct.
Yeah, I mean, percentage can be manipulated so much. I mean, we see it in the archery industry, you know, with top speeds, you know, and how that top speed's measured with the size of the arrow, you know, with what poundage of limb, you got on the bow. There's so many different variables. And if everybody needs to stick to that same measurement, which they don't, so they can beef up their speeds, you know, it is a selling point. So I guess that'd be the same thing like what you're saying. You've got an exact number that you can stick to. That's something I didn't know.
Yep. So that's helpful.
Absolutely. And what's like the 1.7, 22, what's the max caliber presser that you guys cover?
We are developing one right now for 50 caliber for the M99, the Barrett 50 cal.
Mm-hmm.
We've got them for the 240. We've got one for 338 Lapua. We've got one for 375 Chi-Tac.
Mm-hmm.
We've got one for 416 Barrett. And so we've got some of the long range stuff. We've got some suppressors on the U.S. rifle team who's shooting them out to 2 miles.
Okay.
Right. Paul Phillips, the king of the 2 mile, shoots a GSL Copperhead. And so that's exciting stuff. He's got a couple reviews and some of his thoughts and, you know, information on GSL's product line there.
2 miles.
2 miles.
2 miles, yeah.
Reach out and touch somebody.
Right?
Exactly.
Quietly.
You know? And looking at these suppressors, I've seen black ones. Is there any other colors that they can get them in?
So, yeah, we could do FDE really easily, right? We could do, you know, any color, honestly.
Okay.
We could set up whatever color you'd prefer. Another option is we can ship them naked, right? We could ship them with no coating on them at all, and you could have your, you know, your FFL, SOT, Cerakote them to whatever color you'd prefer, or do a design or a, you know, American flag or Kryptek or whatever you'd prefer. And recently we started shipping some of our titanium models that are naked and polished.
Okay.
Right? And so they had a gorgeous finish to them. So that's an option as well.
Everybody wants to customize, whether it be color, finish, you know, it's like with archery industry.
You got
to
bedazzle.
Exactly. Everybody wants a bedazzled firearm or a bow or whatever it is that they're using out in the
field. Right?
Sure.
I tell you what, we're bumping up on our second break here. Let's get this one out of the way. We'll come back. We'll see if we got any more questions here, and then we'll continue the conversation.
Sounds great.
We'll be right back after this.
PSE Archery has always dominated the speed category. Now, the most revolutionary cam system ever to hit the market has perfected the shooting experience. Introducing PSE's Evolve Cam System, featuring extremely high let-off capabilities and the smoothest draw cycle in history. No other cam system has ever delivered this level of total comfort and total control. Experience PSE. Experience performance.
Welcome back. Third segment of the show. You know, we talked about suppressors. We talked about GSL technology and how they got started and everything, and, you know, the importance of using a suppressor for safety reasons for your hearing. Let's talk a little bit about the law and obtaining one. And you and I talked before the show about a personal buy versus, or an individual buy versus a putting it in a trust for other people as well. And I was actually, you really give me some great information on. So I guess the thing is let's start about, how do we go about getting one, and what does it take for us to actually buy a suppressor?
Okay. So suppressor, you cannot go to a gun shop and take off the shelf and walk out with today. Okay. Since 1934, suppressors have been regulated under the National Firearms Act. Okay, they are lumped into the same category as fully automatic machine guns, right? And so the process to attain a suppressor is almost identical to that of getting a machine gun.
Okay.
You have to pay a $200 tax to the ATF.
Mm-hmm.
You have to get a set of fingerprints. You have to get a set of passport photos. And you have to do the paperwork and the background check, obviously, for every suppressor.
Okay.
And so it's completely legal to own. Right. But there's definitely way more hurdles in the way than there are even to buy a handgun.
So
if you walk into this, you walk into the store and you see a suppressor, they have suppressors, and you buy two of them, it's going to cost two times $200. Each one gets a tax stamp, and you have to provide the fingerprints and the photos for each suppressor.
Correct.
Okay.
And most often the dealer will do those for you, right? Or send you to a law enforcement agency who can roll the fingerprints, and you can go to CVS and get the photos, right? It sounds really complex, but honestly, it can all be accomplished in less than a half hour.
Okay.
You know?
Absolutely. And so it doesn't take much. And the way we've gone with electronics, they can do it electronically, especially down at Island Armory. It's all done electronically. You do it right on their little handy dandy little finger scanner. It's kind of a pain in the butt. Answer the questions, fill out the form. But
you don't get ink on your fingers.
You don't get ink on your fingers. No.
Don't ask me how I
know
that.
Right?
Speaking of, with a CPL, does that make it any easier? in any regards to obtaining a suppressor?
Not really.
It doesn't do you any
Not
favors.
Really.
Okay.
It doesn't really do you any favors. You, even if you are a current law enforcement officer, you still go through the exact same process, the same background check. They send your records to the ATF and the FBI, and they make sure you're not a felon, all right? But essentially, if you can go and purchase a firearm, you can go purchase a suppressor, okay. You know, as far as the background goes.
Okay, so now we decide we're going to buy our suppressor. Now, a pro and a con to, do I put it in my name, or do we put it into a trust situation?
Okay, so trusts are becoming more and more popular, right? They're getting easier, but they still require a ton of paperwork, and I'm not a super fan of trusts, honestly.
Well, give us your honest right? opinion.
The reason why is because I don't loan my firearms to people, mm-hmm. and I wouldn't loan my NFA items to people either. Mm-hmm. Okay. A lot of people think that somehow they're circumventing parts of the law by having a trust. But in reality, you are still subject to every single restriction of it. You know, you can still, every time that you add an item to the trust, if you get a new suppressor, right, you need to have the fingerprints and the photos and the background check for every single person on the trust.
So literally, right? so if I go get one, I just do my set of fingerprints and my photo. But if we do it in a trust and that trust has five people on it, five people got to all be subject to giving fingerprints and photos.
Correct.
Every time you add another NFA item to it, a suppressor, you do it again.
And so it makes it overly complicated. It's more paperwork. It takes longer because they have to do the background checks on five people now instead of one person. And so it's not something that I personally advocate for, because even the myth that you are going to somehow avoid another tax stamp is not correct.
Okay.
When you, if you are an individual owner of a suppressor and you pass away, your child, whoever's in that will to get your estate, right, fills out the background check. They don't have to pay the $200 again, right? They do the background check and then they own it, right? It's a slightly different process. It's a tax-free transfer.
See, and that was the way it was kind of sold to me through a private FFL. We had talked about this, and he said, well, a trust is the way to go because, you know, upon my demise, my kids would get them, and it wouldn't be that big of a deal to go through for them to have them. But what you're saying is it's actually easier for them to get them through a will after my demise.
Yep.
And right. It's not impossible, you know. In my mind, the cons, you know, the negativity around it actually outweighs it. Every suppressor that I have, I mm-hmm. personally own as an individual. And when I'm gone, they'll figure it out. Okay. You know, I don't loan my suppressors to people. I'm always there. You know, that was something we talked about earlier, too, is if you go to the shooting range with your son,
right,
he doesn't have to be on the trust in order to shoot.
Right.
Okay. In order to hold the suppressor, he doesn't have to be on a trust. The suppressor gets tied to you as an individual, and wherever you're traveling, wherever you're shooting, right, you can hand it to your son and say, here you go. Right. And he can go and shoot it on the bay next to you and be completely legal.
Gotcha.
As soon as you give it to him for the weekend and say, hey, go to the shooting range, I'll be there tomorrow.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Now it's a problem.
So treat your suppressor like your driver's license. Don't leave home
without it
and keep it by your side.
Or keep it locked up at home.
And don't be loaning it out for weekends. You know, hey, can I borrow it? No. It's
not like the keys to the car.
Right? No, you can't have it unless I'm there, which is great information because, you know, the whole trust thing. I could just see, I know that I'd have two people on my trust if I were to do one. So that means all three of us would have to go all mm-hmm. down to the place to do it every time.
Right.
Okay, so, well, let me throw another scenario at you. Not that this would ever happen because I don't sell firearms. But if I had a gun that I did not want to keep anymore, and I wanted to sell it to Danny. Danny wants to buy a rifle or a pistol that I've got a suppressor on. What does an individual-to-individual sale, how complicated is that?
So that's a little more complex. right? Because it has to go through an FFL.
Okay. Okay.
A firearm, if I am shooting this pistol and then I get tired of it and I don't want to shoot it anymore, I can sell it to you for cash,
mm-hmm.
right? There's very little red tape wrapped around private sale of firearms from one individual to another.
Mm-hmm.
As long as I don't think that you're a felon, right. I can sell it to you right. without any problem. But a suppressor has to go through a dealer, has to, you know, be on another form four. Okay. Right? So there'd be another tax stamp because it's transferring to another non-FFL holder,
okay.
you know? And so it's the resale market for suppressors is very, very, very low. Right,
because well, you know there's $200 cost to it right off the bat.
Well, there's going to be anyway if you go buy one. If you go buy a new one or right. buy one used, it doesn't matter either way for the person buying it. It's just the fact that you went through all these steps and it's so hard to. It's not really hard. It's expensive to get, and you had to wait for it. That you really don't want to be selling them. I guess
right.
is the point.
It's a really, really good reason to do some research and get the right suppressor the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Instead of having buyer's remorse of buying the wrong thing.
Right.
Gotcha. Here comes a good question. And talking about warranties for GSL's equipment, what kind of warranty comes with?
So GSL has an unconditional lifetime warranty on all of our products.
Okay.
Right. If you ever have any issue with it, if you have a baffle strike, right, if something happens, you can drop it in a box, get it back to GSL, and we'll repair it for you, and we'll ship it right back to you.
Can't beat that.
Can't beat that. We've been talking about pistols and rifles. Question is, can you put them on a shotgun or maybe a muzzle loader?
So shotgun, GSL does not currently have any models for a shotgun, right? It is possible. There are some other manufacturers in the industry that do shotgun-specific suppressors, but we don't currently have one in okay. production.
But there are some out there. GSL just doesn't have it.
Correct.
Mark Coleman, I am not going to answer that question.
Hey, Dan, is there a height requirement for suppressors?
Thank you for asking that question. That keeps me out of trouble.
You got to be this tall.
And keep your hands and feet in the ride at all times.
You know.
There's no.
Sometimes.
That's good. Yeah, I love it when the guest gets in on the action.
I know, right?
Denny right. Steiner, he says that he was introduced to suppressors in Africa, and he said they were amazing on everything from 22s to 375.
Right, so. Exactly. So, you know, how long? Nice. So how long does it take, do you know, to get your... So you go buy the suppressor, then you got to file the paperwork with the ATF. Do you know how
correct.
Long it's taking roughly about to get that approval back? It's not like a. It's not like when you go buy a firearm, it's pretty instantaneous. But how long, what's the return on the okay from ATF?
So there is not a mandatory wait period. Okay, there's not a set period that says, hey, you cannot have your suppressor for 90 days or whatever, you know? There is some major red tape around the ATF processing period. And historically, if you would have asked me that same question 1 year ago, I would have told you 12 to 13 months. Mm-hmm. Okay, is the average wait time for Form 4 processing for a suppressor. But things have changed in the last 90 days that are very significant in this industry. Right? The ATF rolled out this new system, this e-file, electronic filing system. And with that development and that rollout, the wait time, the average time that people are, you know, from the time they submit that paperwork to the time they can take the suppressor home is dropped down to like 30 to 90 days now.
That's significant.
Right. And so. right now, as I talked to Natalie last week, she had the latest one was back at 77 days.
Mm-hmm.
So thank God for the government getting into the electronic aid.
Yeah, right. Finally.
Right. So another question while we're throwing these questions out. Can you buy insurance on your suppressor like you can firearms itemized? Do you need an appraisal? Will it greatly increase the value of your firearm?
That is a really good question. I would assume you could insure it under, you know, a property coverage policy. You know, I can call up State Farm, call up my insurance agency and say, hey, I bought a new gun safe. I would like to insure it.
Mm-hmm.
I think you could probably insure a suppressor for the, you know, for the value of it, for the retail value of it. Do you need an appraisal? Will it greatly increase the value of your firearm? That also depends on the firearm too, right? There are some that are very specific niche market suppressors.
Yeah.
You know, so say this guy here, this one's developed for the M11, right? The Mac 9, Mac 10 series. And if I have a transferable Mac, you know, transferable M11, I could put this on here and sell it with the weapon, obviously, because I wouldn't have a significant need for it after I've sold the weapon.
Right.
So I could sell it and it would be, you know, an addition to it, be able to sell both of them and process the paperwork on both of them at the same time. But definitely an interesting question.
So could you bore sight a firearm with a suppressor on it?
Definitely. Yeah, that's no problem at all. I mean, if let's see, grab a suppressor, right? I can get this lined up. Probably not.
Tilt up just a little bit.
You had it.
Tilt up a little bit.
There you go.
Boom.
Tilt the muzzle end towards us. Up.
Up.
Yep. Tilt the muzzle end up. Right there.
Boom. There it is.
Yeah.
So I mean, obviously, there's a slight overbore. This board's slightly larger, just so that if there's any wobble in that bullet, whatever, they go right through the middle as well. It's just, and be totally fine.
Yeah, it's just an extension of the barrel of what you're already shooting through.
Yep.
Except it's not touching it as it goes through.
Correct. So yes, you could definitely bore sight with it. Another thing that's really fascinating about how GSL does quick disconnect suppressors. Right, there are quick disconnect and direct thread units on the market, and GSL has this patented bi-lock flash hider that has two different size locking tabs on it. Okay, and as the suppressor drops onto this you'd put on your weapon, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
You'd put on your 223, your 556 weapon threads on there. The suppressor drops over the top of this flash hider, okay, and then you push down and rotate a quarter turn, and it's locked on there. So it's really, really simple to get on and off.
Mm-hmm.
The advantage of this bi-lock mounting system is that because those tabs are different sized, the suppressor is going to go on there exactly the same way every single time.
The orientation is going to be exactly the same.
Right. Instead of, rather than like a ratchet mount that would have it, you know, click, click, or click, 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 you know, it would be in a different place.
Mm-hmm.
That's really fascinating and something that's kind of a game changer. GSL includes those flash hiders in the box with every suppressor that they sell. Nice. And they keep them in stock also.
Okay.
Which is pretty significant.
Well, they make them right there in the plant.
Right.
Exactly. And so that helps your inventory control, which one of the things that seem to be happening around the country is supply, right? So
I thought we got rid of that term on this show.
Well, you didn't get rid of my hype joke on the show.
I didn't say it. He did.
Oh, so now you blame the guest. I see.
No, I'm not blaming anybody.
I didn't say it. Mark said it.
Mark said it.
Oh, here we go. I see how you three are all.
Yep. I tell you what, let's get our last break out of the way, and we come back.
We got some questions, and we're going to have some fun questions.
All right.
And not short questions.
Well, I don't know. We'll see. All right. We'll be right back after this.
Acceleration is part of PSE's DNA. PSE pioneered the speed movement. Now they've developed the vapor category to help you find the most powerful bows on the market to fit you.
High speed equates to intense power and building the momentum you need to be successful. Are you a vapor shooter? Find out at pscarchery.com.
Welcome back, last segment of the show. Before we go any further, I want to give a quick shout out to the Flint River chapter of the National Wild Turkey Federation. They are having their annual turkey workshop at Williams Gun Sight in Davison
this Saturday, 1 to 4.
There you go.
And they're going to be giving away, I think they're going to be doing the drawing for the turkey gun at the end.
Okay. And so Dan Prince, former DNR, is going to be there as a guest speaker.
And one of the Williams' gunsmith speakers.
Okay.
So
talking about things you can do to your shotgun, I assume?
Yep. That's what I'm guessing. So, okay, couple questions. Since GSL is right here in our home state in Jackson, do they offer like tours or public? Do they have a public showroom or anything like that?
We do not have a retail storefront, right? We don't really have a showroom area. That might be something that we look into in the future, is doing like public tours as we kind of build our space.
Okay.
We do for, you know, FFL dealers. Mm-hmm. We've kind of have an open invitation for them and for military personnel. Right? If you're military, if you've served our nation, you can stop by our facility. We'll give you a quick tour and show you where the manufacturing's done. But it's not really a formal, you know, right, registration exactly. of tours yet.
Yeah, no, nope. Gotcha. That's fine. Another question is, if you buy one can you use it on different hunting guns? So could you have the quick adapters on different guns as long as they're within the same
caliber,
right? It could be a quick disconnect system, right? You'd have multiple quick connects.
Of course.
Okay, that's right.
Of course. Our most popular selling suppressor is called the GSL Multi-Cal. Right? And it's rated for 300 Win Mag and down, right? So you can fire that on your 300 Win Mag. You can put it on your 308, your 300 Blackout. You can put it on your 7.62x39. You can put it on your 223 weapon. It's actually rated for 96 different calibers.
Wow.
And so it gives you a lot of flexibility to kind of swap between different weapon systems.
It was called the Multi-Cal, right?
Multi-cal, yep.
We got it right up there on the screen. We're going to show it for everybody to see. But yes, you can. You get this suppressor. You get a couple different.
I need to work some more overtime.
See, isn't it nice to have Kevin on spending our money for us? It's great.
It happens right. a lot on this show.
But that's good to know because, you know, it's one of those things that you could have the one suppressor and just swap it in the guns and to go.
Well, that makes it worthwhile, sure. too. I mean, you buy something nice and high quality. And you could be able to use it on more than one platform.
Yep.
Yep. That multi-cal suppressor is made with titanium. Right? It's rated for full auto fire. And so you can definitely put it on a very wide selection of weapons.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Start saving now.
Right. Exactly. Start saving your pennies. Get your order in. But it sounds like it's...
Okay. Mark Coleman has... Talking about the Easy Connect. Obviously, after spending some time on the range firing your weapon, and you go to take the suppressor off, is cool down time. I mean, obviously, it's going to be depend on how many rounds, but it does heat up, right?
Suppressor heats up around 6 degrees for every round you fire.
Really? Okay.
So if you dump, you know, 120 rounds, it's now hot enough to cook bacon on.
Or your hand.
Or your hand.
Okay. Something to be cognizant.
Okay, I'm going to ask the obvious question in your statement. Have you cooked bacon on it?
I've cooked bacon on it.
Something tells me he knew it is like...
That was specific.
Yeah, bacon.
Very specific.
Because right. Nobody would make that up.
Right, yeah. It has to be bacon. Everybody loves bacon.
It's pretty America. Season it with some gunpowder.
That's right.
So to answer the question, there's a couple things, right? Aside from burning your hand on the suppressor, which is obviously a problem, it also impacts your mirage, right? If you're looking through your scope and mm-hmm. you see heat coming off of your suppressor, mm-hmm. you'll see those heat waves in your face.
Right.
And that's a problem, obviously. It's definitely a problem for long-range shooters.
Never thought about
and
that.
Yeah. And so I've got a suppressor cover here on this guy. Right, that's got my Kryptek camo that was done by a small veteran-owned company down in Texas. And they do the embroidery and the logo and everything on there. And it has a core that is silicone that kind of disperses some of that heat. And then this wrap allows you to hold on to this after you've been shooting it. And so that's cool. There's a lot of suppressor wraps on the market. Right, and so definitely something that's popular as you put more and more rounds down range. Your suppressor will heat up, and it could burn your hands for sure.
And I got to assume that wrap helps with that mirage issue as well.
It does. Okay. It does.
Yeah, I never would have thought about the mirage on long-distance uh-huh. shooting.
Well, it kind of makes sense after a while, right? You see that. Well, I guess you just need to charge your target.
Need to what?
Charge your target.
Oh, okay.
Yep. So that's kind of interesting. Really awesome questions.
Hey, Well, when we got a guy within the know, we want to try to find as many questions as we can, because it's just one of those things we don't know. But if we get our audience involved, maybe we get Mark Coleman to maybe order one up for his rifle or something.
Yeah, you never know.
Oh, that's a good question. Okay, so that's a good question, now that I just thought about it. So we've seen the mechanisms to put the suppressor onto the rifle and stuff. What if you have a regular type bolt action barrel? What's the involvement that needs to be done to put a suppressor on that?
Okay, so this is one of our most popular for your bolt action weapons. It's direct thread, right? And it has a retention system that GSL patented that uses a Belleville washer, right? It's almost like a lock washer, and it stops the can from ever walking off on you, right? Obviously, okay. As metal heats up, it expands. And so there's a common problem in the industry of suppressors coming back off the threads. And using this retention system, we're able to stop that from happening. This suppressor is all titanium, and it's developed for 300 Win Mag. I can also set up this same suppressor and gauge it down for my 6.5 Creedmoor or my 350 Legend, right? Because you have a lot of hunters, a lot of guys that are using bolt action weapons, mm-hmm. and they don't want the look of a quick disconnect flash hider on there. We can do something like this. It would be direct thread. It would thread right onto the end of the barrel, right? If your barrel doesn't have threads on it already, then that'd be something that you could look into a gunsmith for,
putting the threads on for it, right?
To get them threaded, yep.
And I see you do have one for the 308, the GT308, obviously, right? Is that what that one means?
We do. We've got them for 308. And like I said, that GT Mag platform, we can set up for 350 Legend. We can set up for 6mm, right? The 6mm arc and a very wide caliber spectrum.
Okay, before we get in towards the end of the show here, because we're kind of getting close on time, and before we get into Danny's fun questions, if for a new person that's looking to get a suppressor for a pistol or rifle, and they walk into their local gun dealer, what is probably the first couple, two, three questions that is really important that they need to ask to make sure they're getting the right equipment for their firearm?
Getting the right suppressor makes all the difference in the world, of course, right? You would want to know the calibers, first of all. What calibers do you expect that suppressor to function on, right? Because obviously the suppressor that is perfect for a .22 caliber would not be the suppressor I'd recommend for a .338 suppressor, right? Mm-hmm. They're very different. You know, the guy that's using a suppressor for daily carry, right, for your nightstand, for concealed carry, he probably is not going to use the same suppressor as the guy who's, you know, setting up his MP5 or his AK-47. And so there's a lot of variables that go into what suppressor would be best, right? I would personally look at the caliber that you are going to use most often.
Okay.
You know, I'll tell you my first two. My first suppressor was the GT-556. That one's a quick disconnect suppressor. It's dedicated for .223. I shoot a lot of ARs. And so that was my first can. My second was the Stealth 9mm can. Okay. Right. And I got that one specifically because I could use it on 9mm pistols. I can use it on the MPX. I can use it on PCCs, fixed barrel weapons. Right. I've got half by 36. I've got one. I've got mounts for the Uzi, the Scorpion, the MP5 tri-lug mount. And so having that flexibility for 9mm was important for me as well. And so those were my first two, just based on the calibers that I shoot most often.
So based on caliber, an estimated average weight of a suppressor?
The weight of a suppressor,
as we go up in caliber, would they get bigger?
It depends, for sure.
Okay.
GSL builds this guy, the smallest suppressor in the world for .22 caliber. Right, it's called the GSL Pillbox 22 suppressor, and it's less than 1 ounce. Okay, that's pretty interesting for the Beretta Bobcat and the Lifeguard and some of the smaller 22 caliber weapons. And it's, again, it's less than an ounce. As you get up into .223 and .308 cans, you're starting to get around 12 to 13 to 14 ounces. Right, it's still less than a pound. And then, you know, some of our 9mm can, that Stealth I was telling you about, mm-hmm. that's 7.2 ounces, Right, so that's super lightweight.
Yeah, you're still under a pound when you're talking to the upper calibers.
You're not adding significant weight to the front end.
You're not adding significant front of center, front of
exactly. By the time you get to a suppressor that weighs enough that it would be an impact on your weapon's already on a tripod or a bipod anyway, and it already weighs 15 or 20 or 30 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right?
So adding, you know, another 14 ounces to it is not a problem, you know?
Exactly.
Minimal.
And with suppressors and that, if your handgun and you have a suppressor on it, the question is, do you find any issues if you're having a laser sight on it interfering with it at all?
Not a bit.
Nope. Okay, so there you go. No problems there if you have a laser sight.
No laser sight, or wouldn't affect that. Wouldn't affect a tactical flashlight or anything like that.
No, it's totally fine.
You know, we've been talking, this is our fourth segment now. We've talked about suppressors and everything that GSL has to offer. Where can people go to look more into this if they want to go peruse GSL?
So that bit.ly link that I shared with you, right? bit.ly/GSL links. Right, that has all of our YouTube and Facebook, and it's got our product listing, and it's got our catalog on it, and it's got everything that you would want to know in initially getting set up with some of our product line. You know, guys that are FFL dealers can click on there and find our dealer sign up and look through some of our product info. YouTube's an incredible resource. We've got a lot of videos, cans firing. When you were looking at that multi-cal listing earlier on the website, there's a section on there that says everything that you would want to know, and it's black. And I've done some videos on those that show a very in-depth breakdown of the suppressor, the mounts, how they function, and how, you know, how the specs on it work. So, yeah, fascinating stuff. That bit.ly link for sure.
You get there, you go to YouTube, you probably can type in GSL, it'll probably come up. Then you can go there. You can go look at Kevin's own page there as well. If you get into the bit.ly link, we'll put this on our Facebook page when we post. We'll put the bit.ly in there so you guys can all go in here and check this out. It's a great little place to go.
All right, Danny. I know you've been itching to ask a few questions here, so I'm going to turn you loose.
Are you?
Well, we've got just a couple minutes left, so you're going to have to run through it.
Okay, so. All right.
Here we go.
Yeah, that's right. You're a salesman, so you're a traveling kind of guy. So, with that being said, what are you listening to on the radio as you're traveling or driving to? Or, you know, what do you listen to on the radio? Are you listening to podcasts, rock and roll, country?
I'm usually making phone calls and linking up with new dealers and law enforcement agencies. But I do have Spotify, and I listen to my Up North Journal there.
Hey, there you go.
I like listening to a lot of business development stuff. Okay. Right? I'm listening to one right now called 300 to 3000. It's really interesting about a business that was growing and scaling its business. And so I like to stay on top of the industry and see what's new in product development and, you know, new things that are out there.
Busy making money.
Definitely.
There you go.
Okay,
he's not messing around. He's making money.
He's a guy that, you know, he wants to listen, get some information, and learn. But obviously, you got to have a snack or something. What's your go-to snack when you're feeling snacky?
I like licorice. Good and Plenty's are my guilty snack choice.
You're the man. That's awesome. That is a good one for the truck, especially when you lose them in the hand, they go flying. But that's awesome. So question number three. Mike and Dan are coming over, and you're going to feed us. You're going to make us your favorite type of outdoor game meal. What would it be? What's your go-to for Mike and Dan?
My outdoor game meal. I'd probably build some chili, right? Some venison chili or something.
There you go.
That'd be good.
Nice and hot.
That's not spicy, right?
Hot. I mean, you flame it up.
Yeah, I love spice. I'm all about it.
Okay.
That's awesome. Now,
you bet.
Last question. We're sitting, but we finished dinner. We've done sweating through the hot chili. We're sitting around your palm tree in the backyard, and you're going to tell us you're going to tell us your story that really hit home with you about you. What would it be?
It could be a hunting story. It could be a kayaking story. It could be just a life story.
Oh dear. So I grew up in Michigan and Indiana area, and I was in Boy Scouts.
Okay.
Right. I went all the way through scouting. I went to Philmont, went backpacking out there in New Mexico, and I got Eagle Scout in 2003.
Wow.
And so that was awesome. Huge. Obviously huge. And I spent a lot of time outdoors and camping and rappelling and, you know, had a really diverse skill set and experience just based on that. And so, I mean, I'd tell you a story about that. Okay, you know, I'd tell you a story about some of my scouting and camping experience that really made me who I am and gave me the skills to survive in the wilderness, you know.
What was your final project, the big project that they do at the end?
I built a road.
Seriously? Right?
Yes, I built an entire road. It was a quarter mile long through a nature trail in Butler, Indiana, and it was massive. We had 32 triaxle dump trucks that dumped the gravel for the base layer of it. And we had volunteers from the community that came out, built, you know, it spent, I think we spent 3 months on it, right? Tilling up the ground, removing the earth, dropped in the base layer of gravel and built like a, it was like a nature trail access road area through that section.
Okay. Is that like in a state park or county park or something?
It was in a local town park. Yeah.
Okay.
In south side of Butler, Indiana.
Nice. So I'm in Butler. I'll have to go travel that way.
There should be a little,
a plaque
in your name.
Right. This is Kevin's road.
Is there? Did they put one there for you?
I don't know. Cause
I know like here in our nature, that we have the Donner Trail.
Yeah.
An Eagle Scout did a, I guess if you want to say, a raised walking platform for a section of it. And they put a plaque there for it. You know, that was his final project, right? So, well,
that's awesome.
Congratulations on that. and just so everybody knows, if you go to Kevin's page, you're going to see his page here. He's got his face there. He's got his beard on. And he's got some hair in that picture, not in the live shot, but you click on that, you go to the bottom of the page, you see his card, you scan. If you click on the knee Biden target.
Oh dear.
And you want to pull up a target that you want to use. It's called the Biden target. And instead of anybody coming at you, and the first thing you do is shoot kill, shoot them in the leg. So it's got a picture of a knee with a bullseye right on the knee.
There you go.
So
nice,
right?
I love it. I love it.
There you go. Oh. But no,
I did not know he was going to do that. I think he got you back for the other one.
no, actually, that was cool. It was funny when we were talking on Monday about them. I was looking at a site and I saw that. It has been a pleasure having you on. So I think we're getting to show I'm out of questions.
Yeah.
And I don't see any questions popping up here, so.
All right, I tell you what, we'll wrap up the show. Hang on with us after we sign off, and we'll chat real quick with you. But that's going to do it for the show tonight. Go over to Kevin Kinzer's social media. Go over to that link that we showed you. Danny will have that up. GSL Technology as well. Go over and give him a like, follow, share the show, and do the same for us as well on our social media sites. If you're listening to the podcast over on iTunes, make sure you give us a review. That helps us and it helps our supporters as well. So, Danny, you're working on next week's
guest? I'm working on next week. Hopefully we have somebody to talk to about turkey hunting.
There you go. We're going to try to nail that down this weekend,
This weekend, yep.
All right. So that's going to do it for us this week, folks. Y'all take care. We'll be back again next Wednesday night, same time, 7:30 here on Facebook. Y'all take care now.
This episode was brought to you by PSE Archery, Yamaha Outboards, Better the Hunt, Easy Cut, Packer Max, Deer Camp Coffee, Buck Baits, JPO Game Calls, Limwalker Game Calls, Wild Seasoning, Total Peep, Sunrise Archery, Scent Lock, and Scent Blocker.
Thanks for listening, and join us again here next week. Until then, remember, as we always like to say, if you're out on the water or in the woods, shoot straight and be safe. Until next week on the Up North Journal.